This is the final video in a series dealing with atmospheric circulation and pressure distribution. In this unit, we'll talk about air-sea interaction featuring El Nino invading Southern California, La Nina putting the chill on San Diego, Walker causes trouble in the Pacific, and the oscillation observations. So El Nino invades Southern California. El Nino has a bad reputation. El Nino derives its name, the baby, or actually the baby boy or the boy baby, derives its name from the nativity, as these weather systems generally develop around Christmas. About every 40 months, the waters along the West Coast from Los Angeles to Peru become unusually warm. These warm waters generally flow from east to west, but at irregular intervals they will move from west to east, and that gives us the bad a really bad weather. It's not a good thing to have happen. The warm waters alter weather events due to their warmness and moisture that it adds to the atmosphere, and can bring strong storms to the United States Southwest. And it also affects us all the way into the interior and through the Southeast as well, too. So it's not just limited to the U.S. Southwest, though they do tend to bear the brunt. And it can make for relatively wet and snowy winters, because these generally hit anywhere from November through February. And basically, I'd say hit. These are actually gradual changes that occur over months. They can actually see these things beginning in January, and then by the time they usually take maybe 7 or 8 months to develop. But I'm getting ahead of myself. This map shows sea surface temperatures for September 18th, 2012, courtesy of the National Weather Service, the Ocean Prediction Center, in doing some background work to see if what was currently going on. It doesn't look like temperatures are currently high enough for El Nino now, but there is some indication that temperatures are warming, and it's possible an El Nino watch, El Nino is developing, and so they have posted a watch. So it's quite possible that this winter could end up being a wet winter, a wet snowy winter. But so you'll want to keep current on these things, particularly if you have any kind of interest in transportation or agriculture. You sort of want to know when these are going on, because on the flip side of El Nino is La Nina. And La Nina can put the chill on San Diego, and not just San Diego, but on the entire southwest and southeast part of the United States. La Nina, the baby girl, develops on occasion, doesn't develop with the same regularity that La Nino seems to, but it's essentially the opposite of El Nino. La Ninas don't necessarily follow the same cycle, but they can develop after an El Nino has dissipated. La Ninas are characterized by colder than normal sea surface temperatures. This cold sea surface promotes cool, dry air, which moves inland into the United States and brings dry, cool, dry conditions. And so it can actually have an adverse effect on agriculture. It's good for fishing, because the fish like really cold water, particularly like the salmon, but it's not so good for agriculture in the southwest and the southeast part of the United States. This is an image taken from January 2012, the La Nina. This is an omen to the drought we experienced throughout the United States, because when these develop, if you can see these developing early enough, then you can make some long-term weather forecasts about what will happen later on in the year. And if you watch these ocean temperatures develop off the west coast of the United States, you can kind of get some sense as to what the general weather trends might be like, whether it's going to be a rainy summer, a dry summer. And also, you have to sort of bear in mind, too, that doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be good for the entire part of the United States, because these were both La Nina and El Nino tend to have the opposite effect in the Pacific Northwest, in the upper Midwest, and in Canada. So, for example, if La Nina brings dry, air to the southwest and southeast, it's quite possible that the northwest in Canada will experience rain. And with El Niños, it's the reverse. It can mean that Arizona, New Mexico, and the southeast part of the United States get a lot of rain and some snow, and it ends up being dry in the Pacific Northwest and in Canada. So there are these conditions don't normally are not exactly global in scale. I would consider them to be either synoptic or a mesoscale phenomenon, depending on just exactly what we're looking at in terms of weather. Walker causes trouble in the Pacific. I wanted to make some joke about Walker Texas Ranger here, but Pacific is a little too far for Walker Texas Ranger to have jurisdiction, right? The Walker circulation might catch blame for both El Nino and La Nina, but it's more of an innocent bystander. The Walker circulation is more of a conceptual cell model, like the 1-in-3 cell circulation models we've looked at earlier. Basically, what it tries to do is describe the overall general movement of air over the Pacific from high pressure in the east, the western U.S. and western South America, to low pressure found in Indonesia, Malaysia, and Australia. So that's the general movement of air over the Pacific, but it doesn't always happen like that. And when there's oscillations that occur that disrupt this general Walker circulation, those can lead researchers to investigate whether a La Nina or El Nino is ramping up to occur. The oscillation observations. Okay, so I just recently made a comment about oscillations. So basically, oscillations. If you think about a pendulum oscillates, right? It goes back and forth between one position and another, and that's essentially what these oscillations are essentially trying to describe. Is that we see pressure oscillations between places in the Pacific, and we see temperature oscillations between locations in the Pacific. And so these oscillations, in some cases, there's the Southern Oscillation, which refers to pressure shifts between Darwin, Australia, and Tahiti, and there's also oscillations in the North Atlantic. Now, I don't want to give you the idea that it's only between Darwin, Australia, and Tahiti where these pressure changes occur. That's where the measurement stations are, and those two locations have been monitoring atmospheric pressure for over 100 years. Because they were stopover points for fishing and for whaling fleets and for military expeditions and for trade and commerce. And so Darwin, Australia, and Tahiti just sort of became de facto standards for measuring changes in air pressure and also these days also temperature. So it's not just that these things happen at Darwin and happen at Tahiti. They just kind of got lucky, and those are measurement stations. So these are basically a global phenomenon that we're trying to. These oscillations are global phenomenon. So the Southern Oscillation refers to the movement of pressure systems, or the variation in pressure systems might be a better way to explain it, between Darwin and Tahiti. And the Southern Oscillation Index is a measure of the difference in pressure between Darwin and Tahiti, from the average pressure experienced over the range of decades over which these measurements have been taken. So a positive value for the Southern Oscillation Index can indicate that the pressure gradient slides from Darwin to Darwin from Tahiti, meaning that a La Nina is forming. A negative Southern Oscillation Index, the pressure gradient slopes to the east, and an El Nino is forming. And so, if it's sloping to the west, essentially, that means it's pushing currents westward, and cooler and colder water is forming to the east. If it's sloping to the east, then it's going to be pushing warmer water to the east. And then an El Nino is forming, and so that's basically what you need to know there. Is if you're dealing with a positive Southern Oscillation Index, you're probably going to be dealing with a La Nina, If it's negative, then you're probably going to be dealing with an El Nino. And that's basically what this graphic illustrates. As you can see, the years where they've taken measurements and looked at the pressure difference between Darwin and Tahiti, the red spikes indicate high pressure in the west. So if you've got high pressure in the west, it's going to push everything east. If you've got low pressure in the east, it's going to push everything west. And so the blue represents La Niñas, and then the red indicates El Niños. The Pacific Decadel Oscillation, the PDO, is a global scale pattern of sea surface temperature change which occurs every 5 to 20 years. Now, you might see it every 20 to 30 years, but in putting this information together and consulting the NASA JPL website on this, they state that these patterns occur somewhere between every 5 and 20 years. Sea surface temperatures modify, forming a horseshoe pattern. So I've got this horseshoe pattern illustrated here to kind of highlight it, which connect the northern, western, and south Pacific with warm temperatures surrounded by a cooler middle Pacific. The warm water is less dense and expands and thus has a higher elevation than cooler, more dense water. And so what they do with this, they're looking at sea surface temperatures, but they're also looking at the sea surface elevation, the sea surface height, because the height is directly related to temperature. The warmer the water is, the warm water expands, it increases in height, and so then they map that height. And as they map the height of the sea surface, they know, well, if they see places where the ocean is welling up, they can say, oh, it's warm here versus shallow here. And in the shallow area, the water is more dense. It settles just like cold air settles. And so this is a cool area. And so they're able to make temperature calculations based off of sea surface height because there's a direct relationship between height and temperature. Cooler places are good for fish, especially the salmon species in the Pacific Northwest. Cooler is not good for agriculture because cooler phases bring dry weather systems, and dry weather systems usually bring droughts. The oscillation observations. Okay, so we're not even done with oscillations yet. We've talked a little bit about Pacific oscillations. There is a North Atlantic oscillation. It's also a global scale pattern of sea surface temperature change in the North Atlantic. This has a lot of variability to it. And in doing some background work on this, these are very hard to study because there is so much variability with these oscillations. That tends to be a lot of variation, not just between like winter and spring and summer and fall, not just between seasons, but even between years they don't behave the same. And so they're really hard to do pattern recognition on these things because sometimes, in fact, there was a period from about the 50s through the 70s where the North Atlantic was in a constant negative phase. Which, if you read ahead, the negative phase refers to lower heights and pressures across mid-latitudes, generating a pressure gradient force which moves south. And so basically what ends up happening is it pulls cold air north into the south. And so there were low temperature deviations. It tends to bring rain and lower than average temperatures to those areas. If you read down below, it says in a positive phase, the eastern United States and northern Europe experience above average temperatures in a positive phase. Well, from about 53 to 77, it was in a negative phase. So the way you read that is it's essentially the opposite. So eastern United States and northern Europe would have had below average temperatures. They would have reached northern Europe, which receives more precipitation in a positive phase, would have had less precipitation in a negative phase. Southern Europe, which receives less in a positive phase, receives more in the negative phase. And there was a lot more rainfall as well, too. I don't have that on here, but there was more rain in the eastern United States over that about 20-year, 24-year time period. This image shows the above illustration shows the North Atlantic Oscillation for the year 2005. Again, it's the Jason satellites, which measure sea surface height, basically the topography of the ocean, and then they correlate that back to sea surface temperature. All right, so let's review a number of things. What is El Nino? El Nino is an alteration in the normal flow of ocean currents, which brings very warm water to the west coast of North and South America. What is La Nina? La Nina is an alteration in the normal flow of ocean current, which brings cooler than average water to the west coast in North and South America. What is the Walker circulation? The Walker circulation is a cell-based model which attempts to describe the global scale movement of air masses from east to west across the Pacific. What is the Southern Oscillation? The Southern Oscillation refers to an atmospheric pressure change between Darwin, Australia, and the island of Tahiti. What is the Pacific Decadel Oscillation? The PDO is a pattern of Pacific sea surface temperature change where a large pool of cool water becomes nearly enveloped by warmer water. What is the North Atlantic Oscillation? The North Atlantic Oscillation is a seasonal and annual pattern of sea surface temperature change in the North Atlantic. However, variability in occurrences is so great that the North Atlantic Oscillation is proving challenging to study. And then finally, what is the Southern Oscillation Index? The Southern Oscillation Index is a measure of the pressure change between Darwin, Australia and Tahiti. Positive values indicate La Nina, negative values indicate El Nino.